course.
And we're going to do a photo presentation now with this new photography book called Brother, Brother in Brackets. These are two photojournalists who created the book. It's Alon Skuy and James Oatway. You will have seen them in newspapers all over the country and the world. I'm going to hand over to them, and what they're going to do is go through a few of the images that we'll have on the projector. The book is here and outside. When we're done, they'll take some questions and they'll be available for signings in here afterwards. So I'm going to hand over to you guys.
Great.
Thanks so much.
Thanks.
Maybe I should just explain. Morning, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us today. I'm not sure if you guys know anything about our book at all, but if you don't, I'll just tell you a very brief roundup about how it came together and what it's about. So it's about xenophobic violence in South Africa. So both Alon and myself, we used to work, I used to work at the Sunday Times, and Alon still works at the Sunday Times, but we first encountered, we got our first taste of xenophobic violence in 2008, when there was massive attacks that broke out. So I'm sure some of you can remember that. So many people were killed. The violence lasted for probably more than a month. It spread across the whole country, and tens of thousands of people were displaced as well. So that was the first time we saw it, and we were both quite shocked by this phenomenon. We hadn't seen it coming, you know. After 2008, finally Mbeki deployed the army, as I said, after about a month, and then the violence started to subside, and it kind of disappeared for a while. There were still sporadic attacks happening around the country. Maybe a spaza shop might have been attacked here or there, but it wasn't a sustained sort of outbreak of violence, but it was sort of quiet, you know, and I personally was like praying that we'd seen the last of it. I was like, okay, that was just a once-off kind of thing. But then in 2015, there was another big outbreak of violence. And then again, it lasted for a couple of days. It was when Emmanuel Sithole was murdered. And then the army was deployed much quicker than in 2008, and the violence subsided. But then there was no real big period of where the violence had abated after that. Then we started seeing outbreaks every year, and it's becoming more and more regular now. It's, even last year during the level 5 lockdown, people in Tokoza, in fact Paula Park on the East Rand, Zimbabwean residents were rounded up, and all their furniture was taken out of their houses and burnt in the middle of the street in broad daylight. Now those attacks, unfortunately, we documented it, but it was after the deadline of our book, so it's not included. But my point is that xenophobic attacks are happening more frequently. Even this year, there were some in Durban already. And that was really the motivation for us to put this book together, because we were sitting with all this work and it was just kind of gathering dust. And we felt that it was important for us to keep the conversation going, to have this book come out there and remind people of the dangers that lie in intolerance and indifference. And and just to really make people think before they act.
Hi guys, thanks for coming and having us here. If I could just speak to how the book came about, is that these images were subject of an exhibition in 2018 called Clean Out at the Holocaust and Genocide Center in Johannesburg, and that coincided with the 10-year anniversary of the first outbreak in 2008. And we felt that the center was a perfect place to contextualize this work. And from there, with sponsorship from the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung, they generously sponsored this book. And then we felt that these images needed to be a historical record of what had happened, because of the denialism that we keep seeing from kind of government and from different sectors of society, and the kind of rhetoric that is still carrying on. And that's how that we came to this book.
So we're just going to show you a selection of pictures from the book. It's not all of the pictures. There are some quite graphic images. So if you're sensitive, you're please just sort of be prepared. But it is important for us to show those images as well, because, you know, unfortunately, it's a very ugly thing, xenophobic violence. And you have to, you know, experience that brutality in some way. What we've done in the book, though, is we haven't used it in a sensational way. We've tried to temper it with some of the essays that have been written by various, you know, academics and so on, and also other pictures that show, you know, migrants in daily life and, you know, portraits and that kind of thing, to balance it out a little bit. So we're going to show you a selection and we'll talk you through that. And then if you want to ask us any questions, you know, perhaps you even want to stop us on a certain picture or go back, we can also do that if you've got questions.
I'll just give about 3-4.
Yeah, so this picture was actually taken on in 2008, and it was while there was xenophobic violence, that original outbreak of violence that I mentioned earlier. But it was also election day in Zimbabwe, and it was the election was seen as a sham election. There were accusations of intimidation by some of ZANU PF's youth militia known as the Green Bombers, and it was really the height of the crisis, the political crisis in Zimbabwe, and we saw a massive exodus of people from Zimbabwe at that time, and you know, people were desperately coming under the fence, and then they were coming from that crisis to, you know, the crisis of xenophobic violence that was happening in South Africa at the time. So yeah, that's the story of this picture. This was when violence broke out in Alexandria Township first. That was the first place that it broke out. And we were there at night, and this mob was gathering, and they were going around from house to house, knocking on or kicking down doors and bringing people out and demanding to see people's ID books. Because they claimed that a lot of the IDP houses in Alex were occupied by Zimbabweans and Mozambicans.
Sorry, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
In that previous image, how are you guys received when you're taking images like that? I mean, that's quite a confronting. I mean, they're there to extract people who don't belong. Do they not view you in the same way?
It is quite difficult, but it really depends from situation to situation. So, you know, sometimes, can you go back? So if you see there's like a bit of a blue light in the background of that picture there. So here there were some police present as well. So, and there were quite a few photographers present at the scene as well. So I think in this particular incident, it was more like felt a bit like safety in numbers. But there are times where you're actually on your own there, and it's your how you are received depends on how you respond as well. So it's a very difficult thing to gauge. You know, it's sometimes, like I said, no two situations is the same. You just kind of have to try and sense it, and it's about reading body language, sensing the vibe. Sometimes the minute you approach a crowd, you get rocks and bottles thrown at you. Other times, you're able to, get close and almost be unnoticed. You know, people just accept that you're there. And,
sometimes people are also so caught up in what they are setting out to do that everything else becomes kind of secondary to what their intention or intentions are.
Yeah. So that's a tough one. It's like just kind of do a bit of this, see which way the wind's blowing, and make up your mind. Yeah, this was out in a place called Ramaphosa informal settlement, which is on the east end near Boksburg, and that was actually the scene of some of the worst violence in 2008. That's just the scene from there. This picture was also taken in Alex, and these two guys, they told me they were actually South Africans, and the man laying sort of on the floor there, he was attacked, he was accused of being a foreigner, but they said they're from Limpopo and they're Shangaan speaking, and Shangaan speaking people, when it comes down to xenophobic violence, are often accused of being from Mozambique, because they speak Shangaan in Mozambique as well. But we speak Shangaan in South Africa also. It's one of our official languages. So it just shows you how ridiculous, that kind of violence is.
So this is a picture of a man and a child who also South African, and also shows how a lot of South Africans are also affected by this violence, who are living amongst the violence in these informal settlements. And this woman here, her house was shattered, broken into, that's not her belongings. And a lot of people are secondary effects, not only the violence, suffer from kind of PTSD and certain kind of after effects of this violence. So South Africans are also thrust into this, into these problems, and do kind of suffer a lot of the effects of it.
Yeah, and I think to add to what Alon is saying there as well, what we see these days on Twitter and so on, because you see a lot of today's xenophobia is driven on social media, and you see people using the terms like locust and cockroach, these dehumanizing terms to describe migrants. And then also there's a kind of a movement to, if you have to say that you're against xenophobia, then you are anti-South African. So it's that whole kind of patriot versus traitor kind of argument. And of course, xenophobic violence is as much about South Africans and how South Africans feel neglected by the government and by whoever, as much as it's about migrants who have fled, because of whatever the situation is in their home country. So to address xenophobic violence, you have to, look at South Africans as well as migrants.
So often xenophobia and violence takes different forms, either looting shops or destruction to property. So this this man in Amaphosa Township was trying to extinguish the flames of his home in an area where there were a lot of foreign people did live. And it's just the kind of futility of trying to put out this fire that actually raised the majority of that section to the ground.
Well, one thing about the 2008 violence that sticks out in my mind as well is that, and this is what really kind of made it so shocking for me, is that in the township areas, it was literally a war zone. But in sort of the middle class suburbs, it was business as usual. I can remember driving home one day from like one of these areas where I'd been photographing this violence the whole day, and just driving home and people were stuck in traffic and greeting each other, get out the way. It was like it was a normal day. People were completely unaware, and that hit home to me that in South Africa we really do live in two separate worlds almost,
And the shocking thing for me when taking this picture was almost the normality of the daily scene, where contrasting someone collecting water and this person, people were also inured to the violence that was taking place. This man was killed in overnight violence, and this woman, the lady, were going about kind of the daily chores with kind of a mob of people watching the man. At another stage, kind of police had arrived and quelled the situation. But during darkness and stuff, it's almost impossible to control these types of incidences. And a lot of people wake up to this kind of carnage the next day. So this was unique in 2008 when the violence actually spread into the inner city. So it was predominantly kind of happening on the East Rand, Ipswich, Alexandra, and then it spilled out into the city where people were going into apartment blocks, they were throwing kind of objects from the windows. And this, I believe, was a travel agency. I don't think it's there anymore. It was 13 years ago. They had all the African countries on the wall, and cops were doing routine searches on people who they thought were kind of attacking Nigerians and Mozambicans.
So this picture was actually taken just down the road at the Central Methodist Church, and you know what was quite amazing about during that time is that people fled from you know, migrants fled. And many migrants ended up at the Central Methodist Church, which opened its doors and allowed hundreds, you know, in fact, I think it was a couple of thousand people in the end were staying there. And at night, people would even be sleeping, you know, between the pews and stuff in the actual church. And it was great, you know, at first, but I think it became a bit of a problem because several years later, they were still staying there. And I think that also that, you know, some people had taken advantage. There was this criminal element there. The whole area was said to be very unhygienic because obviously you've got a couple of thousand people staying in a place, there's not enough toilets and so on. And then the church took the decision to, you know, make everyone leave. And this photo was taken in 2015, if I'm not mistaken. And they kicked everyone out, and they did a sort of a intense cleaning of the whole place. So it was, yeah, it was sort of the end of an era of that, you know, what had become a sanctuary for, you know, these displaced people.
James, what was the name of the priest?
Paul Verheyen.
Yes.
Bishop Paul Verheyen.
So, in 2015 as well, there was an organization that was blaming foreign people for the problems of drugs in Pretoria. And a whole group of people were chased into a building in downtown, in the CBD. And this man is peering out because they were accusing these foreign people of having weapons, drugs, and this is just kind of a fear of being confronted kind of hundreds of men trying to pull these people out.
Yeah, so this speaks to what Alon was just talking about. And you know, over the years we've seen many different ways of scapegoating a migrant into in an attempt to justify the violence, which is obviously, you know, you can't justify that sort of violence, but people come up with different, in fact, organizations, you know, consciously come up with reasons. All right, let's think of something we can blame onto foreigners now. So drugs are one of the things. And then some spaza shops, we hear that they sell, you know, goods that have expired and that kind of thing. So yeah, this is what happens in that case. So then the spaza shops get looted in the townships. And it's quite strange because, you know, with that kind of violence, so this is a common one, the spaza shops. These foreigners are selling the outdated, the expired products and poisoning us in there. But the actual migrants don't really get killed in these attacks. So it's kind of a less physical violence. It's more about looting the shops, which is interesting because there's then the different type, you know, which is the ones, the we saw in 2015 and 2008, and that's where people are targeted at them, and you know, it's conscious attempts are made at actually hurting migrants.
And the irony is, throughout kind of lulls in the islands, South Africans coexist, foreign people coexist, buying from each other at the shops, and then kind of in the heat of the moment, I mean, a lot of people's livelihoods are completely destroyed.
They develop friendships, and you know, we often hear of, you know, guys, the spaza shops have given credit to people and all that sort of thing, and people get along and make jokes and that, but then suddenly, like that, you know, it's your enemy. This was during some of the Pretoria attacks in 2017, I think, and yeah, this mob targeted this guy and started beating him. And so luckily he was able to produce his little torn up ID book there to prove that he was a South African. And if he didn't have his ID book on him, I mean, I don't carry mine on me. If he hadn't had his ID book on him, he would have been killed, right? Undoubtedly. So this is the image of Emmanuel Sithole being attacked in Alex in 2015. So what I mentioned to you earlier, and unfortunately, you know, he died from his wounds, and this was quite a big moment in that whole violence, because at the time I worked at the Sunday Times, and this picture went on the front page, and it created a hell of an uproar, you know, even leading to protests around in different African countries, as well as here, and yeah, and it was the day after the picture appeared in the paper that the army was actually deployed, and then the violence was quelled. But it was quite a traumatic incident to actually observe. I'm not sure if some of you have heard of the story before, but I took myself and my colleague, the reporter Borogla Trump, we took Sithole to a clinic up the road. Unfortunately, there was no doctor there. The doctor, it turned out, was a migrant and didn't come to work that day because he had heard about all the violence happening in Alex. So we lost a lot of time at that clinic and then had to take him to Edenvale Hospital. And by the time we got him there, he was already in and out of consciousness, and he hadn't been there long before, you know, the doctors came out and said, unfortunately, he's passed away.
So after that picture was published, as James said, there was a big uproar, and the government felt that they needed to show they were doing things to intervene and kind of quell the violence that was happening. So there were a lot of raids that kind of took place at various hostels, which they believed were a hotbed of the kind of rhetoric and the violence that was happening. And this is outside JP Hostel, where these are Nigerian men whose businesses were torched a couple of days earlier, and I think this guy lost about 20 cars in a panel beating shop. And he's kind of enraged, furious at what is going on, and he's confronting members of the men's hostel, which is about 400 meters from Mabone.
This is all just down the road over here as well.
And the policeman seems to be in. And after that, there were the notorious raids that took place at the hostels. And during kind of at midnight, the army and police went into these hostels and kind of made everyone get out of bed and search the place. And kind of they were very heavy handed, and there was a lot of conversation around dehumanizing way in which they kind of approached this, but they were trying to quell the violence, and there's a lot of debate around that. That's at Alex Hostel, and a helicopter's kind of flying over during one of the raids searching for weapons. another scene that kind of was quelled, where they, a group of men were marching into town, and they saw this person who they believed to be from Somalia, and they started shouting at him. And luckily, someone in the group intervened, and he was actually they let him go. This is a scene from 2019, and there was another big spike in kind of rhetoric and violence, and about 300 shots were moved to be journalistic, and the police had come to intervene, and there was a lull in the violence, and this man who's, who worked at the shop was trying to get all the clothes out before there was another attack. This is a man kind of fainting and trying to get all the clothes out of the shop. Also in 2019, when a group, the Alex Concerned Residents Association, they got wind that there was houses being occupied by people from Mozambique, from Nigeria, various other places, and they felt that these houses had been provided for South Africans. So they went to Orange Grove, and this man claimed to be a South African was thrown out of his house. Every single bit of clothing, couches, everything was tossed out onto the pavement, and his whole family watched helplessly as they took his stuff out. Luckily, the police came late that night and then kind of made them move the stuff back in, but also very kind of heartbreaking scenes. A backyard, and this girl kind of was so terrified. Luckily, they moved on to the main house and let them stay with her. This is as a memorial service of a South African man who was killed during looting via coronation hall. So there was looting going around at a shop, and Somalian owner came and shot a person in the face and passed away. So this is a community warning for that.
It's interesting to note that during these episodes of violence, a lot of the victims are South African, actually, and that might be through acts of self-defense from, you know, migrants who are being attacked, or from South Africans who are wrongly identified as being migrants, or just the police just opening up on crowds and things like that.
This is an image of the Bela brothers from Mozambique, so in 2019, a couple of two t-shirts as two brothers of Sora and Mwaza that are in that camp.
Yeah, this is sort of points to what I was speaking about earlier with the spaza shops, and it's not official, but a lot of people will tell you that, you know, the attacks on spaza shops are often organized by rival local businessmen who have their own spaza shops but aren't able to purchase goods at a cheaper price. So what happens, let's take Ethiopians, for example, they all club together and they're able to buy in bulk from like a cash and carry or something. So they are able to sell their products a lot cheaper than if an individual businessman has to go and buy. That's part of the whole sort of tussle between the who runs the spaza shops and townships. So just an interesting moment that I photographed near Germiston during the 2008 violence. A migrant man, you know, he's got his suitcase with whatever possessions he's got there and just taking a Bible verse. And Alon likes to interrogate this picture. He's like, are you sure you took that in Joburg? Because why is there a seagull in the picture? So this is a picture of a Malawian man, works as a gardener in someone's yard, sends money home every month to Malawi, and is a priest in a local church. And this is just, you know, as I said to you, we chose to include, we thought it was very important to include pictures that show migrants just in daily life, and so people can get to know them more, you know, which that's really the beauty of photography, is you can put faces to issues, you can see perpetrators, you can see the victims, and help us understand these issues more. This lady, Bora, this is quite an interesting story. So she's a Congolese lady, and she fled fighting in the eastern part of the DRC. Her and her husband and two small kids. This little girl is actually deaf as well. And they fled and they made it all the way to Cape Town. And they stayed in Delft in Cape Town. So there's a migrant community in Delft, specifically of Congolese people. So they moved in there. And she wasn't here very long before her husband was unfortunately shot, just in this, like a carjacking or something. So her husband was shot and, you know, left her alone with these two kids, one of whom is a special needs child. And, you know, she was really struggling to get income. And then someone referred her to the UNHCR, you know, the refugee service, and they went and visited her. And they said that she actually qualifies to be relocated to France. So, you know, that was kind of bittersweet. She did actually go to France, but she couldn't really even speak French well, because even though French is a language spoken in the DRC, the area that she was from was the eastern DRC, where people speak mainly Swahili. So she could actually have a little bit of French. But she was also leaving, you know, whatever support structure she did have, you know, in Delft. There were a lot of other Congolese people that were kind of, that she knew she'd become friendly with. And her brother-in-law was there. And it was kind of bittersweet that she was now going there. Yes, like hopefully for a better life, and maybe for her kids anyway, because Delft is a really tough area to live anyway. But yeah, it was kind of sad that she has to go there on her own without knowing anyone over there.
Females kind of going house to house, but also with the loot, with looting and those types of things. Also, there's a lot of verbal attacks, but the actual physical attacks is predominantly male.
But it also depends on certain situations as well. So I can recall last year as well. So with those where the houses are raided. You know, that's where women and children are directly exposed to this violence. You know, some of your pictures, you know, from Orange Grove and those areas, you know, you've got a kind of a crowd of angry men. into your house, they grab all your things, and children are there. You know, it must be the most terrifying thing ever. Also, you know, it reminds me of last year as well in Pola Park. I mentioned it earlier. There was a woman. She was South African who married a Muslim man who was apparently from Malawi. He was at work, raided her house, set fire to her house, set fire to her car, and she was just left there and in the area. She was hit over the head. She had a gash on her head. So women are also on the front line at some point. And there's been other times where, you know, the guys from the hospital here, they'll go out, you know, and they kind of go around the neighborhood. And there you see women actually cheering them on, you know, it's a South African woman kind of cheering them on and spurring them on and cheering and that kind of thing. So, but yeah, you don't really see women like within the actual crowds of people that are carrying out the attacks. I've never seen that, I don't think.
But as James said, when all the guys' belongings were removed out of the women, were removing the actual belongings.
But guys, if there's any other questions, yes.
Yeah, well, thanks for that, Carl. They're great. Just a question, which you must probably know more about it than I do, is that there was some investigation done by Alon Skuy in last year, or I think that traced the Twitter messaging of inflammatory xenophobic critter messaging. And actually, it was the source of very, and it wasn't, you know, I don't know, I can't remember the detail, but they tracked it down to a single source of inflammatory messaging. Yeah. Do you know?
Yeah, so that account was the South African first account. And there was someone who was unmasked for kind of fueling a lot of that stuff. And I think they're just still going on.
Nothing happened.
There's no intervention or anything. That person is still kind of having huge inflammatory remarks and fueling some of the violence that's still happening. But John, was that investigation?
So what's happening there is, you know, these guys are the ones that you see on Twitter, you know, dehumanizing, using dehumanizing language like cockroaches, locusts. You often see that. And this Lerato Pile entity retweets this, and then everyone retweets it. So it's like this. And often you'll see trending, puts South Africans first, or foreigners must put sack, things like that actually trending on South African Twitter. It's very scary. But we've been quite lucky because for now, those tweets haven't translated into on the ground violence yet. It's like there's no connection between them and sort of mass movements, but they are attempting it. And last year there was a couple of marches in Pretoria that these people on Twitter had organized. Luckily, very small turnouts, you know, like maybe 100 people max. But it is still very dangerous. If they are able to reach a large, you know, grassroots kind of movement, then it will be a different story. If they have to, for example, you know, ally with a political party or another party that has a lot of members or clout on the streets, that could easily translate into like proper violence. So I mean, we can't just. This guy can't just be allowed to make these tweets. There has to be some sort of repercussions for that. You know, it's hate speech, and it leads to violence.
I think there was one more question in the back, and we'll need to wrap up and let people go to the next
thing. Thank you. I just wanted to know if Carl has ever turned on you as a photographer, if you ever felt in danger, and then also how you deal with the age-old journalist question, and when people beg for help, or they did experience
James
with
being
annexed and asking for
money
as well. Thank you.
Yeah, so I think there have been instances covering the violence where you're kind of in a group and someone says something, next thing along comes and more on comes, and you just got to actually keep your distance and be quiet. quite intuitive in how you deal with it. Move back, don't get too close. There's encounters in the cars being kind of stoned and attacked. So yeah, I think you really have to kind of trust your intuition and judge each scene or situation separately. As far as dealing with people that are asking for help, often in most of these situations, we are there in the role to document what is happening. There are also police in their role and medics in their role to help injured people. And often in these scenes, there are police very chaotic and frantic, where there are kind of police around and you there to document what's going on. But there are instances where there's no one around, where you can intervene or help someone. That's also a case-by-case situation. The third one?
It's exactly like Alon says, you know, you often do get confronted, but, you know, when a person is part of a crowd, they sort of are more threatening, and it's more difficult to control the crowd. So whenever we are confronted, we try to de-escalate the whole time, instead of, you know, you're not going to try and provoke any further, you know, you just want to try and do your job. So that's just de-escalation the whole time. But so sometimes I think, you know, we're humans before we're journalists or photojournalists, and if we are, you know, in a situation where we can help someone, we will help that person. We're not going to stand around and watch someone bleed to death without, giving any assistance, you know. But it's all, obviously it depends on the exact situation. Like the pictures that I took of Emmanuel Sartori's attack lasted 27 seconds. And I mean, at the time I didn't realize that he had been seriously injured as well. It was only later on when I was told that he'd fallen down that I saw that, okay, he's seriously injured, and that's when we did actually take him to the hospital. So I think a lot of people, I did get criticized for how could you take those pictures without helping. But I think people thought that maybe the attack took 15 minutes or 20 minutes or something, but it was 27 seconds. So it's a very short time to be able to make a lot of decisions, especially when you don't really know what is happening. But yeah, dealing with the stress and that, it's, you know, you try and speak to people, be it your colleagues, your family, therapists, but yeah, I think every individual has a different way of dealing with it, and yeah, it's not easy, and the things that you see do stay with you, and they do haunt you, but it comes with the job. I think, you know, we know that we're going to be exposed to these things if we're doing this job, and you know, we have to take responsibility for that. Very different from if something is happening to us, by chance or whatever. So, but thank you very much for coming out today. I know we're out of time, but yeah, our book is on sale if you want to get it, and we'll happily sign it for you. And thanks again for coming.
Thank you.